Thank you, Lord, for this morning, for your kindness. Thank you for the rain, Lord. It keeps us clean and washes away everything. Thank you, God, for your goodness. You're a kind and gracious God. There's none like you. Have your way in the service. Anoint Pastor Greg this morning and open our ears as we prepare our hearts with worship. Thank you, Lord God Almighty, for your great love. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, Calvary Chapel. How are we doing this morning? Blessed and highly favored. Amen. Let's get a little bit more into it, huh? Didn't have a cup of coffee or anyway, good morning. Those of you joining via live internet, we hope you're having a blessed morning. Enjoying your morning with the Lord as we are here. A few announcements to remind ourselves of the Women of Integrity once a month DVD series, the third Thursday of each month. So that is this coming Thursday, 6:30 to 8:30 here in the sanctuary. Prayer meeting. It is actually the 17th, not the 16th, as it says in the bulletin. It's Saturday, next Saturday, the 17th. It's coming Saturday, 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. But we'd love to have you there and praying for our families, cities, country, everything, right? Just praying in general. Amen. Blessed and Be Blessed Food Ministry. That's going to be the fourth Friday this month, which is June 23rd. As it says in the bulletin, please call, get yourself an appointment. Get on the list. It flows a lot easier that way. Grease Share, Barbecue and Worship and Fellowship. Saturday, August 26th. Amen. At Agate Park, and it starts at 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. And again, as we've been announcing, it's a a family thing. It's a big get-together, games, food, everything's free. It's just a really good time with our brothers and sisters in the Lord, yeah? So if you're available to make that, we'd love to have you there. Prayer at Harupa Valley Sheriff Station by the flagpole. That is going on Thursday mornings, 9 to 9:30, so as we said with everything else, if you are available, we would love to have you there, praying for these brave souls. And as we're getting ready to come up on 4th of July, right, our freedom, they're part of that, right? They're a big factor in that, giving us our freedom to come and go as we please for the most part and protecting us. So be great to be out there to pray for them. Amen. Let us pray before our tithes and offerings, shall we? Oh, and just a reminder, June 14th, coming up this Wednesday, annual Flag Day. It's a National Flag Day. So if you have your flag, go ahead and put that out in your front yard and show your spirit and pride of being USA, right? Amen. Okay, now let us pray before our tithes and offerings, shall we? Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you, dear Lord. Oh, we come to you in faith, dear Lord. Faith and trust, dear Lord, that you are, Lord, our Savior, our way maker, dear Lord. We are just so grateful for you. We thank you for this church that you have provided, dear Lord. Thank you for allowing us to have the time to come here, to be here, to worship you, to enjoy fellowship, worship with our brothers and our sisters, dear Lord. But most importantly, to give you the glory, dear Lord. You are, Lord, our Savior, and we thank you for that. On here at Calvary Chapel, all God's children say, amen. Thank you very much.
Almighty, yes, we are. We're waiting to hear from you, Lord God Almighty. Do your work. Minister Grace, Truth, and Peace through Pastor Craig as he brings forth your wonderful word. Thank you, God, for your greatness. Thank you for being here with us here and in Facebook land. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Man, find us in the river, Lord. Man, with our souls wide open. Speak to us, Lord. We need to hear from you so badly. Praise the Lord. Good morning. What a blessing. Young people are dismissed, if you'd like, and fun and frivolity await. And that is all centered around Jesus Christ. What a blessing. Praise the Lord. Give them a minute to get shuffled away. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right, admit it. Who washed their car yesterday? Who's the guilty party? Huh? I got ambitious yesterday morning. I was up early, and then I thought, well, since I'm up early, I might as well wash the truck. So point your finger at me. I mean, I walked out this morning and thought, what? Okay, praise the Lord. I mean, we love it, but, we've grown up with the old song, it never rains in sunny Southern California, right? No, this is good. This is a real treat. We are grateful. We are blessed. And so if you're thinking about moving to Washington, if you can put up with this, then head north. I can only put up with it for a couple of days in a row, and that's all I'm good for. I'm a California boy. Praise the Lord. Hey, let's hold them high, though, shall we? Let's remind ourselves and even make a, you know, put a stake in the ground for the neighborhood here. We just want to continue to be, we have been and continue, we want to continue to be that light on the hill for this city. We love this city, this is our town, and we would just want people to come to Christ. We don't want to have all the fun by ourselves, right? We want to share the good times with the city of Harupa Valley. So let's remind ourselves what we believe. I believe that this is the perfected word of God. I believe that in the volume of this book speaks about my Lord and my Savior, Jesus Christ. I desire not only to read it, to know it, but through the power of God's Holy Spirit to live it. Amen? What a blessing, the power of God's Holy Spirit. If you wouldn't mind joining me in Ephesians, the letter to the Ephesians church, the churches, Ephesians chapter 6. And so as we know, as we've been going through these first five chapters, Paul has been addressing through letter the multiple Ephesians churches, and these churches are fellowships that Paul established through the power of God's Holy Spirit, we remember. And the first three chapters, Paul reminded the Ephesians church how much God loves them. God so loved the world that he gave. And so if you're breathing this morning, that message applies to you. God loves you. Now, he may not love or appreciate or even receive some of your lifestyle, but he loves you. And because he loves you, he wants to give you direction and guidance. And so that we find great comfort in that reality. That's great. So the first three chapters, even though the Ephesians church, we remember Jesus speaking to the Ephesians church in the book of Revelation. Hey, Ephesians church, return back to your first love. Come back. Come back home. We remember that. And so Paul was making that very clear. Hey, God is, you know, needs you to do some change of lifestyle, but he's not giving up on you. That's what the first three ideas to the first three chapters to the Ephesians church was, that God is not done with you, so return. Come back. And then the second half of this letter, the next three chapters, are Paul is reminding what God desires. So what he's done for us and how we are to respond in Ephesians chapters 4, 5, and 6. And so as we close this letter this morning, let's pick up in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1. And Paul goes on to say, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth. And so, Lord, we thank you for inviting us to this gathering this morning to build us up, to reveal yourself to us, your glory, Lord God. Thank you for the vision that you've given us for our lives. And let us now, Lord God, sit at your feet and allow you to teach, God, Holy Spirit, teach us. And we thank you, Jesus, and it's in your name we pray these things. Amen. Now, we remember in the Old Testament books of Exodus, Deuteronomy, we recognize what we identify as the Ten Commandments. And the fifth commandment is a command with promise. Hey, children, obey your parents. And when you, in doing this, it will go well. In doing this, it will go well. And so that's the fifth commandment is the first command with promise. Hey, it will go well. If you follow your parents, your spirit-filled, godly parents, follow their direction, it will go well for you. Now, we just finished looking last time, we remember, as the household chain of command, if you will, just the organization of the household, as identified as Jesus as the overseer of the church. We saw last time Jesus washing his church with the water of the word. And Jesus is excited. I mean, we're the church, right? The church is not a building. The church is the gathering. The church is the people. And so Jesus has been working diligently, washing the church, washing us with the water of his word. Because he wants to present to himself a beautiful, and may I say, a perfect bride, the church. And so Jesus is working within the church, and we see that. And so we are subject to Jesus. And so we study the life of Jesus. I mean, isn't that the greatest thing, to be able to study the life of Jesus, see how he has handled things while he was on earth, and he still continues to lead and guide, and his wisdom is available. If, you know, all we need to do is just ask him. Ask him for his wisdom from above. Oh, and the minute we do that, we can expect to be receiving his wisdom from above. And so it's very good. It's very comforting for us. And so we're being fashioned, the church is being fashioned for Jesus himself. I mean, one day, man, we are going to be right next to Jesus. I mean, have you thought about that today? That's a good thing, isn't it? That's exciting. It really wipes away any other distractions that are many. But the idea of spending eternity with Jesus wipes away those distractions pretty quickly, doesn't it? That's nice. That's a good thing. That's our Jesus. And then from that, Jesus and Paul was using Jesus' example for in the household. So Jesus' example in the church, and then so the example in the household, the husband, the wife, the children. And we're seeing this idea here in Ephesians 6, verse 1. The extension of that. See, when Paul was writing this letter, he didn't stop and said, well, that's the end of chapter 5, and now let me start a whole new thought in chapter 6. That's not what happened. These chapters and verses for us are just convenient. How convenient it was when I said, hey, join me in Ephesians chapter 6, and we'll pick up at verse 1. Man, you knew right where to go. But we need to remember, Paul didn't stop his thought in chapter 5, and then is picking up a new thought in chapter 6. It's still flowing. He's writing this letter to the Ephesians. And so he began it with Christ in the church and in the home, and now the extension of the home here in chapter 6. So children, obey your parents. It will go well for you. It will go well. Additionally, we find additional responsibility in verse 4. Paul doesn't leave fathers out. So children, obey your parents, obey your father, but you fathers do not. Fathers, do not. Fathers, you have a responsibility in this direction. Fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. Bring them up. So do not provoke, fathers, do not provoke your children. Fathers, do not impress upon your children unreasonable demands. Bring them up in the ways of the Lord. Train up your child, and he will go in the ways of the Lord. The writer of the Proverbs tells us, doesn't it? Train up your child. Don't provoke them. Don't saddle them with unreasonable demands. Don't put them down. And I mean, some folks here in this room have been brought up in that sort of a family system. That's not the way what Paul's talking about. You know who you are. And that those some of for some of sitting here this morning, home life was a horrifying, traumatic event that was thrust upon you as a child. I mean, I can dig it. So we've got to keep this in context. I mean, we can't, for some of us, we cannot use our personal experiences to apply here to Ephesians chapter 6. We've got to be very careful. We have to be very careful because we don't want to go on a rampage and say, oh, no, this system is got to be thrown away. This subjection, children, wives, husbands, Jesus, oh, that's all going to be tossed out because in my experience, it didn't work, so therefore, it's completely perverted. That's not correct. So we've got to keep this in perspective. Children, obey your parents as long as you're being raised in the way of ways of the Lord. We know that we have the discernment on what's right or wrong. We understand these things. And sometimes we have to just put up with certain situations as young people. We sometimes have to. I hope that's not the case here. I hope that's not the case next door and in our children's ministry and our youth ministry, that kids are, you know, are frightened to death and just thinking, man, I hate my household. Now, if that's the situation, well, we got to continue to pray. And I'm available to sit down with parents, single parents or couples, whatever the case may be. I'm willing. I mean, that's why we're here. That's why we've been here for all these times, to minister. So we keep these things intact. We keep these ideas that we've been seeing over the last couple of weeks. We keep them in context. And unreasonable demands across the board are not recognized. Unreasonable demands, as we spoke about the wife submitting to the husband, and then kind of touched a little detail on that, when it's right and when it's wrong. We saw that. If you didn't sit under that message last week, pull up the video. And so we're not talking about unreasonable demands in any of these situations. We're talking about godly direction. And so as children are directed to do so, verse 5, bondservants likewise, Paul says, be obedient to those who are your masters according to the flesh, so those that you work for. In our circumstance today, would be, hey, employees, honor your employer. That would be the context today. Honor your employer according to the flesh with fear and trembling, but most of all in sincerity of heart as unto Christ. That's the context. As unto Christ. Not with simple eye service. I mean, we know what this is going about. Don't try to butter up the boss. And then when he turns his back, she turns his back, you're out goofing off. That's the idea of eye service. Not with eye service as men pleasers, but as bondservants of Christ doing the will of God from the heart. Now, there's been many conversations that I've had with various different people, and someone would come and say, hey, bro, you know that I work over here at such and such industry, and it's a great job. I love my job and such. I'm like, hey, great. I'm glad that job is providing for you and your family. That's fabulous. I mean, we're pro-business here at Calvary Chapel. We're even pro-entrepreneur. And so I was like, great, yeah, and I recognize your company, bro, and I'm familiar with it. And he said, but I'm having a problem with one of the guys who's a brother, and instead of operating his machine between the certain hours, he starts to operate his machine, and then he walks away from his machine and starts talking about the Lord while he should be tending to his machine. Now, you know, and I'm glad that he's talking about Jesus, you know, the report to me would be, but he said, I'm not sure if this is right. And I said, no, it's not right. It's not right. If the time frame is between here and here, and you're to be operating your machine or whatever, cleaning up or framing a wall, whatever the case may be, in between that time period, that's what that person is to be doing. Now, there's nothing wrong with whistling while you work. Don't misunderstand. Again, we've got to keep things in context. But yeah, the guy, he just pretty much stops and is chatting it up with his neighbor there. And I said, no, that's not right. Now, there's a time for that. And that time is called during break time. Then, hey, you know, go grab your coffee and or hang out by the water cooler, whatever the case may be. Then you chat it up. And then as the whistle blows, you say, hey, we'll continue this conversation during lunch. What do you say? Yeah, I'll meet you at table 3. We'll have lunch and continue this conversation. That's proper. That's correct. But here Paul is saying, hey, work unto the Lord. I mean, you're getting paid to rebuild that engine. So get to rebuilding while you're on the clock. Then you're doing the will of God from the heart. Then you're preparing a platform possibly to speak to some of your coworkers during the break time. And then it's appropriate. In verse 7, do these things with goodwill, doing service as to the Lord, not unto men. Do this unto the Lord. Jesus, this is my sacrifice to you. Knowing that whatever good anyone does, he will receive the same from the Lord, whether he is a slave or if he's free. So don't worry about your current context. Serve the Lord in your current situation. Honor God. And you masters, oh, you're not exempt. Just because you hold the reins doesn't mean that you're directing the horse. Oh, you better be letting the Lord direct. You masters, verse 9, do the same things to them. Treat your employees with gratitude and respect. Treat them well. Because you're working as a team. Just because there's a boss doesn't mean that he's not part of the team. I'm a big team guy. Nobody can run this fellowship by themselves. I mean, obviously not without the Lord, but if one man tries to come and run this fellowship by himself, it's a complete disaster. There's talent out there that God is providing, and that talent needs to be cut loose. Hey, man, go for it. Hey, I've got an idea. You do. Hey, that sounds like a great idea. You know what? Take charge of that. There's talent. We have deacons. We have elders. We have people in position because they're skilled. I can't do everything. I don't even want to bother trying. I have to remind myself throughout the week, hey, Greg, you've got 3 studies minimum per week. 3. 3 studies. And 4 presentations. That's a lot. Have you put together a study lately? That takes a lot of effort, doesn't it? That's just one. Well, I'm looking at the clock saying, well, I've got 2 more to put together. Wow. And so I realized right away, I have to devote the majority of my time, and I mean 90% of my time, in the Word. In order to have a study prepared, the 3 studies that are required per week. Next week, I've got 4 studies I've got to have prepared. I mean, I've got them started, but I've got 4 next week, so pray for me, man. By the way, and we're going to meet up, one of those studies and one of those presentations is going to be up at Calvary Chapel Mountain Center, and all are invited. It's Saturday, June the 17th at 11 a.m., till 4. Come on up. There's going to be some great music, great study, great fellowship. We're going to have a great time up in the mountains. Take a break. Get out of the flatlands. That's what we're called. That's what we're considered by the mountain guys. Oh, here comes the flatlanders. So we flatlanders are going to go invade Calvary Chapel Mountain Center and have a great time. And everyone's invited. Anyone's invited. It's a motorcycle-themed event, but that doesn't matter. It's Christ-centered. So you're invited. Good food, good fellowship, good stuff. So, masters, honor your employees because you need them. You can't do this job by yourself. That's why you're hiring people. What are your giftings? What is your gift, Calvary Chapel, Harupa Valley? Let Gary know. Let our head deacon know, hey, I'm gifted in this area. Where can I be used? Stout-hearted men, as we meet Monday nights, the stout-hearted men, most of them are involved. If you're a man here at Calvary Chapel, I need you. What is your gift? Reveal that. Let's see if we can find a place to get you plugged in. Because, again, I got my nose in the Scriptures. I'm back in the dark office there. Half the time, nobody even knows I'm here. But my time is valuable. I'm not trying to hide. I'm trying to say, Lord, speak to me. And man, he's speaking to me. I'm thinking, whoa. Man, I've got to catalog all this stuff. So we need your help. Calvary Chapel. God doesn't need your help. I need your help. Okay, make no mistake. God doesn't need me. He's given me an opportunity, but he does not need me. And so I keep asking him, Lord, would you bring along more of the quality men and women that you've brought in the past? Would you continue to bring them? And the Lord says, I will in my timing. Sometimes I don't like God's timing. So help me out here, guys and gals. I love you. So employers honor your employees. Employees honor your employer. It works out beautifully. Verse 9, continuing speaking to the masters, the employer, and you masters do the same thing to them. Give up this idea of threatening. So Paul is saying, hey, you employers, you masters, change your attitude. The Lord is not approving of your attitude right now. Now you can change today, and then you'll be all right. But give up this idea of threatening, knowing that your own master also is in heaven, and there is no partiality with him. So employers, be very careful. Don't be cheating your employees. Don't do it. Do not do it. In verse 10, Paul says, finally, my brethren. You see how many times Paul says, well, finally, this will wrap it up. You know, 7 pages later. As well as I'm concluding, right? So don't let this fool you in verse 10. Finally, hardly. Finally, my brethren, but here's the real key. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. His might. That means I don't have to do anything. That means he doesn't need me. He needs me to be strong in his might. And let's develop this a little bit. Put on the whole armor of God. Put it on. I say put it on and leave it on. Never take it off. Especially, and people say, well, when I go to bed, do I take off my armor? Especially you leave it on. I don't want to be vulnerable while I'm sleeping. How's that for an answer? Therefore, I never take off, I never want to encourage them. Oh, yeah, go ahead and take your armor off. No way. Put on the whole armor of God. That you might be able, and here it is, you might be able to stand. You might be able to stand against the wiles or the cunning devices of the devil. As you stand with the whole armor, then you can withstand. And with that idea being set up in verse 12, Paul is saying, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. With this statement, we've got to be very careful. Paul, with this statement, is saying, hey, you are trained in combat, physical combat. No, you because he's acknowledging, hey, you wrestle against flesh and blood. You wrestle against flesh and blood. And so you prepare, you've studied, you've been a student of the art of combat, physical combat. You've been a student. Anybody here that's been in the military knows, and you will say, hey, I have some training in combat. I've been exposed to some level, different military services, different levels. But anybody, man, woman, or child that has been in or is currently in the military has been exposed to wrestling with flesh and blood to some degree. So you've been trained. And Paul is acknowledging, hey, you've been trained. You're wise. You have been trained in the art of combat. You've been trained. That's what is being acknowledged. He's saying, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood in the upcoming idea that I'm going to present. But Paul is acknowledging, in the flesh, you have been trained. You've done well. You've trained well. Some guys here are boxers. Other guys here are trained martial artists. Other guys trained wrestling, men or women. And man, the women are really coming into the MMA. I mean, it's almost brutal. I mean, I know you don't watch any of this kind of stuff, and I accidentally click on it. I'm a combat guy. I'm sorry. Don't hold that against me. I'm sorry. You know, I'm sorry. Praise the Lord. But I got to be careful. But I just, you know, Paul is acknowledging, though, hey, you have been trained in some sort of combat. And that's good. My hat is off to you, Paul is saying. That's great. You've done well. And so again, so that kind of paints the picture a little bit. Let's go back to the first part of verse 12. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but wrestle against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age. So guys, there's a difference. Paul is saying there's a difference between wrestling against flesh and blood and wrestling against the spiritual forces. And so this is where Paul is separating the two. And we want to make sure that we see that he's making that very clear. Hey, you've done well with flesh and blood. Way to go. Well done. But this is completely different. This arena that I am walking you through, Ephesians Church in Calvary Chapel, Harupa Valley, this arena is totally different, and I need your attention, Paul is saying. We wrestle against principalities, powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood. We wrestle against spiritual hosts. Therefore, what you're doing right now, Ephesians Church, you're entering in the spiritual battle. You're entering in with your training in flesh and blood. And you're failing. This is not a flesh and blood fight. This is a spiritual fight. And you're entering in with carnal weapons. Paul writes to the Corinthian church, said, hey, our warfare is not carnal. It is spiritual. And so Paul is trying so hard to get the attention of the reader. You're doing great in the physical realm, but you're failing miserably in the spiritual realm. Because you're trying to use the tools that your combat trainer has given you, and that's not going to work. It's not going to work. So it's not going to work, verse 13, therefore. So the flesh and blood approach is not going to work. Therefore, here's what you do. You take up the whole armor of God, as we've seen already, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. So are we starting to see the definition here of spiritual wrestling? I mean, wrestling between flesh and blood is trained by a combat artist, yes, but the spiritual wrestling, the definition of wrestling is stand. That's the first thing that we need to understand. It's stand. In combat, physical combat, we go forward, we attack, we engage. But in the spiritual realm, we stand. That's God's definition of wrestling. And Paul is saying, you better get that, and you better know it, and be reminded of it. You put on that whole armor, and you stand. You don't engage. You don't go find that devil. Oh, I'm going to find that devil, and I'm going to put the whoop on him, man. Talk to the guys that went in and were not prepared, not called by the Lord, the sons of Sceva, and they thought, oh, we're going to go in and exorcise this man from this demonic stronghold. And that demon said, you know, Jesus, I know. That demon went on to say, even Paul the Apostle, I know him. But answer me something. Who are you clowns? And that demon-possessed man, that guy, with all his demonic activity going on in him, which he wanted to be freed from, trust me. But those demons put the whoop on these guys and threw them out. Not only slapped them around, but stripped them naked and kicked them right out the front door. That's humiliation, wouldn't you say? Beaten, bloodied, and rolling around in the driveway naked. Not a place I want to be. Hey, having done all, you put on the whole armor of God and you stand. You stand praying. And trust me, when I had that kid right in my ear screaming at me, in his mother's house, screaming at me and said, "You don't belong here. You get out of here. Nobody wants you here." I just stood there and I looked straight ahead, and the only thing I was doing was praying, "Lord, protect me physically. I mean, I'm here spiritually, Lord, but my hands are down to my side, and I'm praying for this kid." And then I began to pray out loud, and eventually his voice got silent, more silent and quieter and quieter and quieter. But I'm telling you, it was a challenge. I could feel his breath on the side of my face. And in my old nature, I didn't do well with that sort of thing. So, man, I was like, "Lord, this is all you. Every bit of it. I am not moving. I'm not budging." And I literally did all, and I stood. It was not easy. I never want to go through that again. If that's what the Lord has tallied for me, fine. But I'm hoping that maybe it might be one of you guys, brothers. Anybody? It was scary, man. It was scary. I was never more vulnerable in my life. But the Lord protected. I did all to stand. And so the battle belongs to the Lord. We get that. That's what Paul is teaching. Hey, Ephesians Church, hey, Calvary Chapel, Harupa Valley, the battle belongs to the Lord. You do well in the flesh and blood combat. Yes, you do great. You're trained well. Now you need to be trained well in the other arena. The battle belongs to the Lord, verse 14, stand therefore. We're hearing this word now, stand, frequently, aren't we? Whole armor and stand. Totally contrary to the flesh and blood contact sports. Totally contrary. But the Lord is putting our lives right side up, isn't he? Stand therefore, verse 14, having girded your waist with truth. Man, know the truth. Have you got the truth today? I mean, the truth is that Jesus saves. Do you have that? And once you have that in your life, it's never an issue. So you gird you, so you never take this belt of truth off, ever. Why would you take the belt of truth off? You don't. That's the answer. You put it on. You gird your waist with truth, the belt of truth, and you leave it on. Yeah, even when you're sleeping. Yeah. The belt of truth. Furthermore, you put on the breastplate of righteousness. Man, that polished breastplate adorning the upper half of your body. Righteousness. Why would you ever take righteousness off? Don't even think about it. The breastplate of righteousness. Leave it on. Put it on. Leave it on. Leave it on. Furthermore, put your shoes on. Put your spiritual combat shoes on. Shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. We're going up to the mountains this weekend as the Lord tarries. We're going to bring the good news. We're going to go walk around with the gospel of peace, the good news. Hey, God so loved the world that he gave. That's good news. We're bringing that message. We bring that message everywhere we go. So you shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith. Man, you take that shield, and so you've got your armor on, and then you cap it off with this shield that covers you from head to toe. Sounds pretty good. Sounds pretty good. You take the shield of faith with which you are able to quench all. You're able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Not just a few. You're able to quench all of the fiery darts of the wicked one. All of them. If you have your shield. So if you come in and say, wow, the devil really got in between me this week. Well, you put your shield down, didn't you? Yeah, you must have. Why'd you put it down? Yeah, I must have. Yeah, I put my shield down and a fiery dart got in. You know, in some translations, the idea of fiery dart is changed to the fiery missile that's headed your way. Keep that shield of faith in position all the time. Don't open yourself up. Keep that shield. Embellish your bodily armor. Embellish that with your shield in place. Take the helmet of salvation. This is one that we need to be much more aware of. All the armor of God needs to be on the soldier, both men and women. But the helmet of salvation, you know what? I need to touch the helmet of my salvation now and again. I need to touch it and briefly, and for a moment I think, where am I at in salvation? What am I doing? And I touch my helmet of salvation and the Lord reminds me, you're saved. Because this is where the battleground is in the brain. Jesus has my heart. That's done. Satan knows that. Jesus has my face tattooed in his hand. Tattoos are forever, right? Some of us are just now realizing that in our elderly years, thinking, wow, didn't think I was going to live this long. But with Jesus, he uses the better ink. So born-again believers, your face is tattooed in Jesus' hand. It's tattooed. In other words, it can't be removed. It's there permanently. And so the enemy knows that Jesus has your heart as a born-again believer. Are you born again today? As a born-again believer, Jesus has your heart, and the enemy knows that. So where does the attack continue? Right here, in the brain. In the brain, he starts stirring that up. And so what do? Oh, I don't have any armor. Oh, no, wait a minute. I have a helmet of salvation. I put it on. I never take it off. And then when I'm kind of getting beat up a little bit, if something's starting to, when I just entertain foolishness on my own, then the Lord reminds me, hey, touch the helmet of salvation that's on your head. Because you've forgotten that you're covered. And I say, oh yeah, I don't need to entertain any of these stupid thoughts that I'm allowing into my mind. I'm going to flush them all out right now. I'm going to cast these things unto the Lord. Because I'm oh yeah, that's right, I'm saved. Oh yeah, hallelujah. The helmet of salvation. I think that might be one of my most favorite parts. I touch it often. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, Lord, thank you. Thanks, I needed that. Right? That high karate guy, smack. I see you laughing. All you old guys are laughing. You know that commercial. Smack. Oh, thanks, I needed that. Oh, yeah, I needed that. Oh, yeah. Man, this is good stuff. That's why we don't forsake the gathering of the saints. This is good. Anybody feeling a little bit better right now? I know I am. Wow. So take the helmet of salvation. Man, I love it. And then finally, take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Never set it down. I love it now. We got these great electronic devices, right? We got Bible apps on here. Anywhere I go and somebody says, oh, open up your Bible, and I think, oh, okay, well, great. I didn't know a Bible study was going to break out. I'm fine. I'm still fine. Great. Be right there. You know, Matthew chapter 5, whatever, bang, hey, there, hey, all right. You know, let's hold them high, and believe, when we first started, let's hold them high and profess and proclaim the Lord. I'm thinking, man, this is weird. But it's the day and age. We all have these. We have a Bible app, and we use it. We never put our sword down. I heard a guy one time a great guy just loves the Lord, and he says, you know, I didn't bring my sword today, but I got my dagger. He's got a little I don't even know how he reads it. You know, it's about this big, you know. He says, I got my dagger, man. I'm good. I said, man, way to go. You got your dagger. That's great. So, man, you know, we have fun with this stuff. We know. We get it. We get it. Paul. Thank you, Paul. Thank you for being under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and sharing these things with us. So the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, we got it. We have it with us. And praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Supplication, in other words, pleading with the Lord. Pleading. Man, our prayer chain is filled with prayer warriors that are these men and women are pleading with the Lord on behalf of Calvary Chapel. We've got a great prayer chain. We've had a great prayer chain from ever since I can remember. We've always had a prayer chain. And these men and women are pleading with the Lord for the saints. You're not familiar with the prayer chain? Get the phone number. It's in your bulletin. Call that number and leave a prayer request. And I promise you, within 5 or 6 hours, your prayer is on the Calvary Chapel prayer chain. And people are pleading unto the Lord. And then I want to encourage you, when you get a praise report, man, call that same number and say, hey, thank you, praise the Lord, this is what the Lord's doing. Because we like those praise reports. I mean, we're soldiers, no doubt. But it's nice to, you know, kind of get thrown a bone once in a while, right? So on both scenarios, call that number. Call it day or night. Call it. And so Paul is saying, hey, pray, plead in the Spirit for the body of Christ, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for the saints. So plead for the saints. Lord, touch the body of Christ. And while you're at it, pray for me, Paul says in verse 19. Pray for me that utterance, in other words, boldness, may be given to me. Boldness that I may open my mouth to make known the mystery of the gospel. Remember this mystery that Paul explained last time when we were together? Paul saying, it's a mystery to me that Jesus Christ, God the Son, the King of heaven, Paul was saying, it's a mystery to me that Jesus Christ came down from heaven. Paul's just saying that I cannot fathom that. Paul is saying, it blows my mind, man. It's a total mystery that Jesus would come down. And he didn't just come down for a day, a week, or a month. Paul's saying, it boggles my mind. It's a mystery to me that Jesus would come out of perfection and spend 33 years with us. That's a mystery to me. But God knows why. Paul knows why. God loves us. That's why. But in human terms, Paul is saying, in my human side, it's a total mystery to me. Why would God the Son do that? It's a total mystery to me. But I get it. I mean, we get it. You know, a mystery is to be searched out. And Paul has spent his life searching out this mystery. And so now he's encouraging us, hey, present the gospel mystery to those around you. I mean, search it out and find a way for you to feel comfortable to articulate it in whatever fashion. However you do it, however your personality fits. Shed that mystery with those around you. With your giftings, with your personality. With the power that God has given you at whatever length. So pray for me that utterance may be given to me that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, the good news, for which I am an ambassador in chains, and pray for me that I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. I can't do this on my own, Paul is saying. I need you to intercede for me. I need the power of Christ. So pray for me. Let me touch my helmet of salvation now and again and be reminded, oh yeah, I am saved, therefore I'm qualified to talk about Christ. Paul is just a man. He's not a human. He's not a superhuman. He's a man. Pray for me. Plead the blood of Christ for me so I can do what I'm supposed to do. I don't want to drop the ball. Partner with me. please, Paul is pleading to the body of Christ, please, intercede for me as I intervene for you. And finally, as Paul begins to close now in verse 21, as we will close, but that you also may know my affairs and how I am doing. I mean, we haven't seen each other for a long time. I'm sending Tychicus. Well, who's Tychicus? Well, he's a beloved brother and a faithful minister in the Lord. Oh, okay, Paul, sounds good. This Tychicus, my brother Tychicus, will make all things known to you. So when Tychicus reveals himself, Ephesians church, embrace him. You know he's coming. Be watchful for him and embrace him. When we have a guest, either a speaker or musicians or something, we have guys and gals stationed looking out the parking lot prior to anybody really technically getting here. We're waiting for our guest, and we're going to receive them in the driveway. Say, hey, man, what's going on? Hey, Tychicus, is that you, Tychicus? Yeah, I'm Tychicus. Hey, great, welcome. And so they're not wandering around in the parking lot. Gee, where do I go? We meet them. We meet our guests. We meet our speaker, whatever, our musicians, whatever. We're looking for them. We make them feel comfortable. So, hey, when Tychicus identifies himself, embrace him. Be looking for him. Verse 22, I have sent to you him for this very purpose, that you may know our affairs. I mean, myself and my entourage, I've sent Tychicus with the message that he may comfort your hearts. I know you've been wondering what's been going on with me, and Tychicus is going to fill in the blanks. Good stuff. And finally, peace to the brethren and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Man, don't you love when Paul closes his letters that way? Peace from God the Father and grace from Jesus Christ. Wow. Grace be with all those who love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Not just saying, oh yeah, I love the Lord, and then going out living a lifestyle that is contrary to Christ. No, all those, grace and peace to all those who love Christ with sincerity. And that sincerity is demonstrated. Sincerity is never hidden. So grace and peace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen. Let it be so. Paul concludes, let it be so. I could ask the worship team to come join me. What an absolute blessing as we finished the letter to the Ephesians. A letter that I trust motivates each and every one of us. A letter that reminds us all the things that God has done for us, because he loves us. And then once we realize, recognize, and embrace all the things that God has done for us and continues to do for us, let that be a motivation unto works. We remember earlier, works does not save us, but salvation motivates our works. Works doesn't save us. Salvation motivates our works. Do you need to get involved? Do you need to get plugged in? Do you need to get replugged? Whatever. I mean, whatever the definition is. What do you need? What are your needs here today? Come on up after the service and join our prayer group here and present these ideas to the prayer warriors, we like to call them. Men and women in the prayer team. Make whatever it is God's making known to you. Make it known to myself, to our elder Sam, to our prayer group. Make it known. That way we can confirm what it is that the Lord is speaking to you. We can confirm it. And we can open Scripture and show, hey, this is exactly where you're at. Right here in Scripture. You're in Scripture. Look at you. There you are. Avail yourself to that reality. Amen. Continue to love the Lord. Continue to be filled with his power and his might. And continue to Never take your armor off, but certainly adjust it now and again. Certainly. And certainly check that helmet of salvation and hold that shield of faith, man. Hold it right up. And doing all that, then stand. Amen. So with that, won't you join us by standing? Have a great week in the Lord. Avail yourself to all that the Lord has for you. Certainly for His glory, but for our benefit, both individually and as the body of Christ. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's go out worshiping the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. All of your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path.
Let's try that again. Trust in the Lord.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart.
Hi, everybody. Pastor Greg, Calvary Chapel, Harupa Valley. Hey, we're so glad that you've been enjoying the videos, and we just know that God has been touching you and just giving you a blessing through these teachings. But you know, we'd like to give you a challenge. Since this material is available, as you know, you can go to the website and pull these videos down, but we would like to challenge you. Since you're enjoying these teachings on a regular basis, we want to challenge you, why not share these videos? You've got lots of friends on Facebook and so forth and social media. Why not inject the gospel message, the Bible teachings of the Lord into your share partners? It would be a great opportunity to maybe start a conversation, but we would really like you to be encouraged and consider passing these teachings on. We want people to be benefited, so let's allow the Lord to do what He would like to do. But in the meantime, we're so glad that you've been joining us and enjoying these teachings. They will continue to come as the Lord tarries. But again, enjoy the Lord. Thank you so much, and continue to pray for Calvary Chapel here in the city of Harupa Valley. God bless you, Pastor Greg, once again, and we'll catch up with you next time. Have a great week in the Lord. Bye now.